We all know our history. Germany fought both the Western Allies and the Soviets in World War II and ultimately lost. But this video series asks, what if Germany and Soviets managed to forge an unholy alliance instead of going to war? Would the Axis forces, now stronger for the Soviet superpower, have been able to turn the tide of the war and emerge victorious? For Soviets to join the Axis, a serious rewrite of history would be needed. It would also cause a ripple effect, further changing the map of Europe. And you can try it for yourself by playing Call of War, a free online strategy game that gathers millions of players worldwide. You fight up to 99 other players in real time, and creating alternate timelines is the best part. Trying to make Belgium, for example, the king of the world against real players is challenging, I tell you, especially Belgium with nuclear weapons. In Call of War, you define your strategy, research new weapons and build powerful armies, then take over the world. And Bingo viewers are getting a special gift. Click on the link below to get 13,000 gold and 1 month of premium subscription for free. So hurry up to make your country the king of the world. On to our alternate history. It is 1941. Most of Europe has fallen. Germany lost the Battle of Britain. But then, the German attack on Russia does not happen. The biggest underlying change needed for that would be true sympathies between Germans and Soviets. That's a very tall order, going against their nature, but without that, the alliance would not have been possible. In this alternate timeline, the 1939 Non-Aggression Pact, which carved up Poland and established spheres of influence, is just the beginning. Some further real foundations did exist. Hitler had at times decent words for Stalin. And the real timeline also saw economic, credit and technological agreements from 1930s to 1941. Huge amounts of natural resources were traded. Germany purchased stuff for cash and technology, as well as exported complex machinery. Soviets even got incomplete plans for a variety of German ships, as well as samples of various German aircraft. The oil alone, some 7 million barrels of it, was more than Germany could naturally produce from its own oil fields. All that actually happened. And Soviets and Germany actually negotiated the possibility of Soviets joining the Axis. Both sides wanted their sphere of influence to include Bulgaria and Yugoslavia. The Soviets also wanted to reach through Iran and into Iraq. Germany did not like that. Ultimately, they could not agree. And that's not even taking into account the inherent mutual distrust and Hitler's stance on Slavs as less than human. This alternate timeline has all the leading people trusting each other, willing to cooperate, giving an alliance an honest try to see how it goes. Japan and Russia also grudgingly agree over Sakhalin and Kuril Islands. Mutual trust there is also suddenly high, so both sides move their forces away from each other. The negotiations end successfully. After their Pyrrhic victory over Finland, Soviets make their next move. In late 1940, they push into Iran. And this time they want it all, instead of just taking the north while letting the British invade the south. The British, furious at the Soviets, send more forces to the Middle East. Iraq and Syria are neutral, though pro-British. The Soviets would likely still be careful, not yet openly supporting Germany's war against Britain. As mentioned, Germany doesn't even plan to attack the Soviets. Strategic and long-term plans for development of the German army change in 1941. Much greater accent is put on the air force and naval forces. On the other hand, even though future production of land forces is diminished, without Operation Barbarossa, a lot of the ground forces are available for other theaters. The Balkans campaign goes on as scheduled in spring of 1941, but features even bigger German forces. But there is another change. As planned in their alternate timeline agreement, the Soviets join in the Balkans campaign. That marks the first time Soviets actively work together with Axis troops. Importantly, Bulgaria gives the okay for Soviet troops to pass through Romania to Greece. Bulgaria, as well as part of Romania, come under Soviet sphere of influence, as prearranged with the Germans. Yugoslavia is still conquered by the Axis, even a bit earlier than it happened for real. Soviets agree to let Germany have all of Yugoslavia, free from attacking the USSR. Germany also sends many more forces to northern Africa. By spring 1941, German commander Rommel commands a few times bigger force. By then, Soviet forces take most of Iran and reach the borders with Iraq. The tensions there are near the boiling point. In the real timeline, Iraq saw a pro-German coup d'etat in April of 1941. The British invaded, and Germany helped Iraq fight via Syria. But in this alternate timeline, the Soviet reaction to the British invasion is to invade Iraq as well, from the northeast. German help is also much bigger. The British also invade Syria and Lebanon, and Soviets react too, sending forces there as well. A quick digression, Turkey was mostly neutral in the real timeline. While considerable pressure would be put on Turkey to choose sides, this video won't speculate on the politics behind that. Turkey would, as it was in reality, keep the passage between the Med and the Black Sea closed for all belligerent sides. The conflict between the British and Soviets becomes inevitable. They clash both in Iraq and in Syria, where Soviets fight alongside the Germans. The British declare war on the USSR, hoping that would entice the US to enter the war, but the US is still quite isolationist, as it was for real. It needs that one big push like Pearl Harbor to enter the war. At the same time, Germany and USSR start work on plans for Battle of Britain 2.0. Plane, ship and submarine production starts to rise steeply during 1941, both in Soviet Union and Germany. Weapon designs and tech is shared and traded, but the British still control the seas. On the other side of the planet, in 1941, the Japanese are still fighting against China. Even back in 1939, Japanese had 1 million troops in South China regions. But in this alternate timeline, 500,000 additional troops come in from Manchuria. The Soviet aid to China does not happen. There are some additional Japanese conquests, but their quagmire in China continues. German air attacks on Britain again pick up steam in late 1941. After the Balkans campaign, Germany would have sent hundreds of additional fighters and bombers to France. Germany would likely have more planes in the theater, though still not numbers comparable to totals of the summer of 1940, when the first Battle of Britain commenced, as the much bigger Middle East campaign and control of the Mediterranean would eat up a lot of planes. At the end of the first Battle of Britain, the British had actually outproduced the Germans when it comes to planes. That had continued throughout the war. But in this timeline, the continued German bombing campaigns, ample resources from the Soviets, and redirection of resources going into added aircraft production would make a difference. Germany would very likely be outproducing the British by 1942. The British would be receiving ample support from the US though. In the real timeline, the Lend-Lease program saw huge amounts of goods and products, including weapons, sent overseas. Naturally, stuff that was sent to the Soviets would now not be sent. From the end of 1941, the US had sent thousands of vehicles, aircraft and various goods. It wasn't only the US who was sending stuff to the Soviets. British too, once it was obvious they wouldn't be invaded, sent a lot of equipment. In our timeline, this would be kept for British own purposes. Britain also started receiving ships from the US as early as 1940. Perhaps the biggest short-term boon to the Axis would be the fact losses stemming from the Operation Barbarossa would not happen. While most of the Soviet planes lost in the opening stages of that attack were old designs, by the end of the war, most planes lost were also fairly capable designs. For context, during the entire Battle of Britain, the British lost some 1,200 aircraft. So the flood of additional planes and crews facing Britain would be enormous throughout 1941. A good bit of Axis production would also switch to anti-ship needs. Long-range planes such as Condors would have been made in much bigger numbers, as well as longer-ranged fighters such as Messerschmitt 110. The British would be hard-pressed to defend their convoys. New ships and plane designs would get produced. Longer-ranged plane variants with more fuel would get added. Still, both Germans and Soviets were severely behind when it came to really long-range bombers. It would probably take 1943 or 1944 until meaningful numbers of new type Axis long-range bombers emerge. Even in the real timeline, Germans worked with the Soviets on submarines. At the start of the war, a dozen of the advanced K-class subs were made, and Ku-class was planned at 24 boats. In this timeline, both classes would probably see dozens or 100 built and sent into the Atlantic by the end of 1942. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. In the alternate 1941, the war in North Africa is going better for Germans. The British also send more forces there, but in this timeline they also have to fight a bitter war against Soviets in Iraq and Syria. At the end of 1941, Tobruk falls. The British desperately cling onto Egypt, but influx of fresh resources is now also a problem. The Italian fleet keeps harassing the British ships in the Med. Perhaps even more crucially, the Soviet and German air forces press on everywhere over the Mediterranean. British Middle East becomes very much dependent on Indian and Australian supplies. The British are very much on the defense in the Med. By the end of 1941, the British Navy has to stick to the islands and shores it controls. The pressure on Malta keeps rising. In the Atlantic, even in the real timeline, some US ships escorted supplies to Britain before Pearl Harbor happened. With added pressure and Soviet threat, these unofficial involvements would likely be widespread. With the earlier mentioned pickup in bombing raids on England, the Second Battle of Britain would have effectively already started. The US would be literally giving away thousands of planes and ships to the British by the end of the year. Finally, in December 1941, gloves would come off. After the Japanese strike Pearl Harbor, emboldened by the now seemingly unstoppable Axis alliance, the US would declare war on Japan, Germany, Soviets and the rest of the Axis. As with the Axis, the US production is not as it was in the real timeline. For a year now, the US would have been even more geared towards a war on the seas and fights in the air. Despite the loss at Pearl Harbor, the US takes note of the desperate situation in Europe. It sends the better part of its navy and air force to the Atlantic. The war in the Pacific against Japan is still being waged, but with a smaller force. In the Med, Gibraltar and Malta are still a thorn in Germany's eye. But now the control of the air is substantial, so they decide to go all in and pick Malta as their preferred target. A huge airborne assault follows a massive bombing campaign. After heavy losses, Germany does take Malta in early 1942. While the Axis still can't go out of the Med and into the Atlantic properly, they've at least severed the British supply lines. British Middle East is now fighting for its life. At the same time, during the first half of the 1942, the smaller US presence in the Pacific results in the following. The Japanese take the entire New Guinea, and they carry on eastward. The Battle of Midway also happens. But as the US has fewer forces now, the result is different. Both sides lose several carriers, and the Midway Islands are taken by the Japanese. In the coming months, they also take entire Solomon Islands and conquer New Caledonia, Vanuatu, Fiji, and by the end of 1942, even Samoa. Backtracking a little, in North Africa, the Battle of El Alamein happens in the summer of 1942. El Alamein falls. The US, trying to prevent the fall of Egypt, opens up a new front. Operation Torch happens a few months earlier, in the summer. This time it features even more US forces. Forces that were in the real timeline sent to the Pacific. The influx of US forces is considerable, and the initial move towards Tunisia is fast. But the Germans quickly redistribute their forces. Still, with the fresh US help, Gibraltar is out of German range. On the other hand, by the late 1942, Alexandria in Egypt is under siege. In the Soviet Union, the production potential spools up, not with the same fervor as in the real timeline, as they lack that drive fueled by desperation to stay alive. But their army swells and ultimately they conquer entire Iraq. The British see that Egypt is doomed and finally retreat from there. They establish a new front line in Pakistan and eastern Iran against the Soviets. The British Isles are paralyzed. Perhaps more so than in real timeline. Soviets and Germans start making a vast amphibious assault fleet by the end of 1942. But more about all that in part 2 of this video series, to come out within a week. Until then, salutations! Before we wrap up, try changing history in Call of War. We've set up a special game of Call of War for the first viewers that click the link in the description. Go to the website or use the app. Type in Binkov in the search bar and enter Binkov as the password. The slots are limited, so don't lose time. Call of War features historically accurate maps and units. You can combine dozens of different unit types, such as infantry, tanks and planes, and fight for world domination in a challenging PvP environment. The games of Call of War can get complex and take weeks to complete. Use your diplomatic skills and forge alliances with other players on both PC and mobile devices with the same account. create your own path and rewrite history. New users that click the link below the video will get 13,000 gold and 1 month of premium subscription for free. So choose a country and fight your way to victory in epic real-time battles. And remember, Binkov may talk about hypothetical wars, but only real peace can bring us all together.